Part 5, Nitty Gritty. Garrison's abortive investigation made one important change to the Buffs. Hitherto, they had concentrated on picking holes in the Warren report, which, they were all agreed, had been exploded. They had no clear ideas as to who really killed Kennedy, even though many believed it wasn't Oswald, and none thought he had acted alone. Once they recovered from the Garrison setback, they were all set for the full conspiracy exposure he had so sadly fouled up through his deranged obsession with the innocent Clay Shaw. But how had intelligent, industrious, and even scholarly readers independently come to the unanimous conclusion that the Warren Commission rushed disastrously to judgment? It is time to examine the detailed arguments adduced to prove what many still believe, that the Warren report was slipshod or dishonest or both. The report said there were three shots only, all fired from the book depository behind the presidential car. It supported this with what it called the consensus among ear witnesses at the scene, though conceding that some heard two, four, five, or even six shots. A very small number of eyewitnesses also testified to seeing a man with a rifle, or the end of a rifle, at the fifth-floor window. The best of them, Howard Brennan, who had been sitting on a concrete balustrade facing the window, actually saw and described a white man of Oswald's estimated height and build as having fired, well before Oswald was arrested. When the Buffs came to examine the detailed statements in the 26 volumes of evidence, however, they found that the consensus was very loose. Of the 100 and more witnesses who heard shots, many were uncertain how many there were, and even more uncertain where they came from. Since some people thought they had heard or might have heard shots from more than one position in the plaza, and different authors place these uncertain witnesses in different categories, it is not possible to produce an agreed percentage of testimony to the various places. But there is no doubt at all that while sufficient witnesses were absolutely clear about hearing shots from the direction of the book depository, a significant and substantial number, over 60 by some counts, also or alternatively thought they heard a shot or shots from the grassy knoll in front of the car to its right. Dealey Plaza forms an isosceles triangle with Houston Street as its base. Main Street perpendicularly bisects the triangle, passing through Houston Street to merge with Elm Street and Commerce Street under a railway crossing, the Triple Underpass, at the triangle's apex. Smooth grass triangles extending back to Elm and Commerce Streets flank Main Street, and gently rising banks of grass ascend from the outside edges of Elm and Commerce. It is this outside, rising bank, running beside the president's car on his right after he had passed the book depository, that forms the grassy knoll. Toward the top of the rise, extruding from behind an ornamental concrete balustrade, a picket fence cuts off a car park, and it was from the car park behind this picket fence that many witnesses thought shots or a shot came. Evidence amassed, too, that this was a site where unaccounted things had been going on, though the mysteries escalated over the years from the plausibly suspicious to the suspiciously detailed. Senator Ralph Yarborough, travelling in the vice presidential car in the motorcade, smelled cordite as he passed the picket fence. He also noticed a man on the grassy knoll fall to his face on hearing the shots and concluded he was a trained combat veteran. Commentators deduced that he was reacting to the sound of shooting from behind him. Several people ran toward the picket fence after the shooting, evidently thinking it was a centre of interest. Muddled footprints around a parked car, and mud on its bumper as though someone had stood on it to take better aim with a rifle, were described. Two witnesses were intercepted at the car park by a man in a suit who showed Secret Service credentials and stopped them. This, it is suggested, proves the presence of illicit conspirators behind the fence, as the Secret Service confirmed that none of its agents had been sent to fan out around Dealey Plaza at that time. A similar false Secret Serviceman has been reported as active at the same time at the back entrance to the book depository. The Buffs also wondered why Secret Service men were not riding security on the presidential running boards, and why the car slowed so decisively as it passed the book depository. In fact, the car slowed because it made a tight turn, and security was not hanging from its sides because this was a deliberate public presidential appearance, and neither Mr. nor Mrs. Kennedy was to be obscured from onlookers. And there are so many different US government services, from the FBI to the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco and Firearms, that the presence of different accredited men at different points on the route, not specifically ascribed to guarding the president, is quite unsuspicious. A few witnesses saw smoke rise from behind the picket fence as the shots were heard. Police searching the railway yards behind the car park half an hour later arrested three tramps hiding in a freight van. But no record of their arrest could subsequently be found, and by the late 1970s, news pictures of the three hobos led some optimists to suggest that they were too well dressed to be derelict vagrants, and to offer tentative identifications of them as Watergate burglars Howard Hunt and Frank Sturgis, with another marksman known to have worked for the CIA. In fact, the misfiled arrest report was later found, and the three men were traced and identified. They were innocent vagrants who picked a bad time and place for a kip in an empty freight car. At the same time, as more and more photographs of the plaza circulated among Buffs, many came to believe that they could identify the shadowy figure of a rifleman or riflemen among the foliage overhanging the picket fence. And witnesses came forward with things they had not previously mentioned. Perhaps the most extraordinary example being an effectively deaf-mute man who in 1978 changed the story he had told the FBI in 1967 about seeing two men running from the back of the book depository to a new and circumstantial tale of seeing a man fire at the president from behind the picket fence, disassemble his rifle and toss it over the fence to a Confederate who ran off with it. This shaky witness avers that he had been too frightened to tell the police immediately, and they had not been able to understand him when he did initially report to them. Now, there's nothing suspicious about conflicting witness stories after a traumatic event. Shock, horror, and panic alter perception. Memory may blot out particularly distressing observations. The different numbers of shots heard from different parts of the plaza can easily be explained. Few people were in a position to hear the three clean shots, with a possible interval of 3 seconds between the first and second, and a more certain interval of about 5 seconds between the second and third, as tentatively proposed by the Warren report. For Dealey Plaza acts as an echo chamber. Sounds reverberate round the space, bouncing off the buildings, and for those in one part of the square, the boom they pick up as an echo may sound more lifelike than the actual crack that provoked it. All this testimony to shooting from the picket fence needs support from something more concrete. And just such concrete evidence appeared to be there in the president's wounds. For Dr. Malcolm Perry, heading the trauma unit that attended the president in Parkland Hospital, told his first press conference that he thought the wound in the president's neck was an entry wound. Dr. Perry is not to be criticized for this speculation. His job was to save the president's life, if possible, not to make a detached and scholarly survey of his injuries. A quick manual investigation under the president's back showed that there was no massive life-threatening wound requiring attention there. Obviously, there was one in the side of his head. But before surgery could be brought to bear on that, his breathing and blood flow had to be stabilized. Work on massaging the president's heart, giving him blood transfusions, and completing the tracheotomy to assist his breathing was just about all there was time for before his pulses ceased, and the doctors knew they had failed. By contrast, the autopsy doctors who examined the president at Bethesda Naval Hospital didn't even recognize the wound in the neck as a wound. It had been obscured by the tracheotomy. Their initial impression had been that the wound in the president's upper back was shallow. A surgeon who inserted his little finger believed he had probed it to its end, and since there was no bullet, they thought it must have dropped out. They found a small entry wound in the back of the president's head and concluded that it had emerged at the right side, causing the massive injury. It was not until they learned by telephone from Parkland that the Texan doctors had seen a small wound in the neck that might have been either an entry or an exit wound that they scrapped their notes and revised their report, concluding that the manual probe of the wound in the back had been inadequate and the bullet causing it must have proceeded further to emerge through the neck. The Bethesda Navy pathologists were not forensic criminal pathologists. They did not normally present evidence for the merciless scrutiny of cross-examiners. Their simple job was to determine cause of death, which they had done. Gunshot wounds. One massive one to the head, proving lethal. Moreover, they were examining the man who had been their president and commander-in-chief the previous day. Inevitably, they treated his body with more respect than might be accorded a rating croaked in a bar brawl. The actively Catholic Kennedy family could be expected to want an unmutilated corpse if possible. There seemed no obvious reason to check the trajectory of the bullet by almost decapitating the president. His brain was removed to be probed or sectioned if necessary, but it seems pretty certain that Robert Kennedy removed it for decent interment at the earliest possible opportunity, fearing its morbid and distasteful exhibition in some path museum unless he did so. Thus, it has never been possible to confirm the Warren Report's theories about the bullet's progress, and, as everyone necessarily admits, they remain theories. And that has made it easy for the Buffs to pounce on the Texas doctor's first casual opinions and declare them probably right. Texas is gun-happy, they observe, so Texan doctors are more likely than Navy pathologists to recognize gunshot entry wounds. Some of the Texas doctors described a vast cavity at the back of the head, yet Bethesda reported this as being to the side. Since clear and accurate photographs of the president's wounds were not taken, and several of the pictures that were taken have been lost, it remains open to commentators to select from contradictory medical evidence. And so the self-styled research community today accepts as a fact that there was an entry wound in the president's throat, overlooking or suppressing the truth that this was the short-lived opinion of doctors who had not seen the actual entry wounds in the president's back and head. But all this allows them to predicate a definite entry wound from the front, and this presupposes a marksman in front of the car. So the grassy knoll shooter can be described as having been proved to exist. The report's critics have found their greatest success in sneering at the report's magic bullet, the one which allegedly passed into Kennedy's upper back and out at his throat before entering Governor Connolly's side, fracturing a rib, emerging from his chest and going on to crash through his wrist and embed in his thigh. The Warren Commission believed they could actually identify this bullet as their Exhibit 399, picked up from beside Governor Connolly's abandoned stretcher in Parkland Hospital after he'd been taken into the trauma room. Ballistic laboratory examination determined that it had been fired from Oswald's Mannlich carcoma. But bullet 399 is almost undamaged. This seemed ridiculous. Bullets are usually flattened or deformed when they hit bones. One of Oswald's bullets had shattered completely, leaving only minute fragments in the car, together with minor damage to the windshield and its chrome surround where tiny pieces had flown off. By the Warren Commission's account, that bullet had simply gone in and out of the president's head. Yet the magic bullet had penetrated his neck and broken two bones in Governor Connolly's body, emerging unscathed. It had passed through living skin seven times in all, something a number of ballistics experts were prepared to swear was physically impossible. Ballistic experiments with dead goats were cited by the commission, and similar ones have been undertaken by and on behalf of the Buffs. They have produced differing results. And the historian is compelled to say sadly that this is one of several true crime research areas in which the objectivity of the science laboratory appears to be compromised by the brief of the commissioning patron, and diametrically opposed results are being reported, so that each side in an impassioned dispute can claim to have the support of scientific evidence. The Buffs had one really impressive piece of witness testimony on their side, however. Governor Connolly was convinced he'd been struck by a separate bullet after the president had first been hit. This meant that, at best, the Warren Commission was wrong to say that only two of the three bullets from the book depository found a target. At worst, that there must have been at least four shots. The governor, who was quite certain throughout the 1960s that he'd been hit by a second shot that missed the president, pointed to objective evidence on the really vital measure of time available to the commission. This is the 8mm silent home movie taken by Abraham Zapruder from a vantage point on the grassy knoll, which covered the entire period of the shots. Unfortunately, a street sign obscures the president for the vital frames covering the start of the shooting. As his car disappears behind the sign, the president can be seen to be erect and waving. As it emerges, he can be seen to be clutching at his throat, having definitely been hit. Just under a second and a half later, Governor Connolly can be seen to grimace with pain, and the governor asserted that he had been struck immediately before that visible reaction. This would be at least a second after the president's neck had been injured, too long a delay to be explained by the same bullet striking both men. The Warren Commission had some very sophisticated experiments carried out, mounting a film camera on a rifle, for example, and testing the effects of sighting and shooting the moving car from the depository window, timed to correspond with visible movements on the Zapruder film. And they concluded that two shots had been fired while the car was obscured from Zapruder, and the second had struck both Kennedy and the governor, whose immediate response to the impact was shown in a quick movement of the hand holding his hat. The grimace followed the painful expulsion of air from his lungs. Critics demurred that the governor's ability to retain his hat in his hand showed that he had not been struck when the commission claimed. A weak point, since he did not drop it for the length of the Zapruder film, during which he was certainly struck. They were also able to point to inaccurate measurements of the president's wounds in the autopsy reports, and an entry wound so far down his jacket that it seemed impossible that a bullet fired from above could then have passed upward through his body to emerge at the neck. The commission's claim that the president's jacket must have bunched up over his back was dismissed in the light of the back brace the president wore, which normally held him erect. The commission's careful analysis of bullet fragments and the precisely angled trajectory which could have carried one bullet through the president and governor were dismissed by the Buffs, who had by now decided that Exhibit 399 must have been planted to frame Oswald by co-conspirator Jack Ruby on the visit to Parkland described by Seth Cantor. When in the 1970s the Zapruder film as a whole was shown to the public, rather than having isolated still frames reproduced, most laymen were instantly convinced that the critics must be right. For the president obviously fell backward in response to the shot that destroyed the side of his head. How could this be? How on earth could a bullet so strike its target forcibly as to pull that target back toward the gun? It didn't make sense. A shot from behind surely must have knocked the president forward. At this point, I myself concluded, like another non-scientist historian, Professor Michael Kurtz of Southeastern Louisiana University, that four bullets must have been fired. One making the shallow probed injury in the president's back, one entering his throat and emerging from the right side of his head, the third striking Governor Connolly, and the fourth blowing away the side of Kennedy's head and destroying the original exit wound. But by the time Professor Kurtz and I independently reached that conclusion, there was further scientific evidence endorsing a marksman on the grassy knoll. The House of Representatives, justifiably concerned by the role assassinations had played in affecting American politics and aware of public anxiety about conspiracies and cover-ups, set up a committee of inquiry into the murders of John and Robert Kennedy and Dr. Martin Luther King. And this very thorough investigation concluded that Siran Siran had indeed been a lone nutter killing RFK, that James Earl Ray most probably shot Dr. King on his own, though he might have had assistance with his complicated and expensive flight from the crime, which included sophisticated false identification papers and travels through Canada and England before his arrest, all well beyond the means and skills of a poor small-time crook. And the committee concluded that there was clear evidence of a fourth shot in Dealey Plaza on a dicta belt in Dallas Police Station. This had recorded incoming messages from police cars and motorcycles on the morning of the assassination. Confused sentences, overlapping each other, were interspersed with patches of static and the sounds of cop cars or motorcycles. But at just the time of the assassination, a speed cop had accidentally left his microphone on for 4 minutes. Officer H. McLean, riding behind the president's car through Dealey Plaza, testified that his mic often stuck in the open position, and so it seemed there was actually a fuzzy recording of the assassination to be assessed. It was a bit of a puzzle. No shots could be heard, and a mysterious bell tolled once. Once somebody was heard whistling, and McLean's motorcycle engine appeared to be idling when it ought to have been racing. But the House Committee turned the tape over to acoustical experts, who determined that there were four inaudible but detectable electrical impulse patterns, which could well have been the way in which the microphone picked up the gunfire. Reconstruction experiments in Dealey Plaza showed that similar impulses could be reproduced by three shots from the depository and one from the grassy knoll. The House Committee reported a 95% probability that a second gunman had been involved, and the greyhounds of conspiracy hunting were slipped from their leashes.